A great wall surrounded the Minecraft town. The Empire of Uldarash and the newly formed Republic of Bardonia would soon engage in a massive battle, one where trench warfare, super soldiers, and peacekeepers would all play decisive roles. This is the second installment of the history of the Golden War, where the new world order of the Stoneworks Minecraft server would be forged in the Battle of Bardonia. If you haven't seen the first part, click right here in the top right corner, join the server today at this IP address, join the Discord below, and remember to subscribe to write mean comments insulting my voice and personality, or I will commit various war crimes against innocent Minecraft towns, like this one. And a special thank you to Bisect Hosting for supporting the Stoneworks Minecraft server. Use code STONEWORKS to get 400% off.
What? Free money?
Oh, 25% off. I got my fractions wrong, but still, free money! So go over there if you want to get your own smooth-running server for tons and tons of games. Last we left off, the Empire of Uldarash and the Republic of Bardonia were both itching for a fight. Two Bardonian players violated Uldarash's territory claims in the gold-rich Mesa biome. Emperor Dentro of Uldarash requested that a massive $100,000 indemnity be paid, but Unicorn Boy in the Bardonian Assembly elected to give him just $100. With both sides thoroughly insulted, war was declared. Uldarash sent its army, made up of players from its small towns and big cities, out to besiege the town of Bardonia. Under the leadership of Commander Whiskey Knight, they built a massive wall that encircled the town, all while the Bardonians were offline and asleep. It didn't have to be this thick or look so good, like me, so gold star for aesthetic, y'all. But for the Bardonians, Uldarash had turned their home, the promised land of dandelions, into a prison yard. But they weren't ready to go down without a fight. Since the Bardonians back to the hub, Azexis, Unicorn Boy, Tizu, Moye, and more all had experience on PvP faction servers. So they sprang to action, setting up the now famous Bardonian defenses. They tore down their town hall and set up an obsidian bunker. Lengths of trenches were dug, moats were filled, fields of berry bushes and bamboo stalks were planted. Walls, lines of cobwebs, and bridges of campfires were all set up, all while Uldarash harassed them. Under bursts of arrow fire, the Bardonians placed anything that would block the invaders, slow them down, or damage them. The instructions to these defenses and how they're best used are detailed in Unicorn Boy's in-game book, The Book of Bardonian Defenses. While Uldarash and Bardonia were prepping for their war, the Var Alliance in the center of Rathnir convened in the Great Hall of Carve. The collection of city-states had good relations with both Uldarash and Bardonia, as they routinely conducted trade to their north and their south. To let a war go down like this would hurt their bottom line, so all the city-states agreed to act in preservation of the Western nation's independence, sovereignty, and security, because at the moment, it looked as if the massive Empire of Uldarash may destroy the smaller Bardonian state. They debated and passed a motion to send troops into the ranks of both sides. They were to act only as peacekeepers, solely there to fight on the defense. Emperor Dentro and Commander Whiskey Knight sat on the wall overlooking Bardonia, and they agreed. They must not let their troops attack first. But the Bardonians in the fortified town knew the same, and they would hold their troops back too. If the Var city-states were successful, they'd be able to withhold the tide of war for the 3-hour duration of the battle, when hopefully peace could be negotiated afterwards. But this just left a lingering tension, which some Uldarashi players would take advantage of. Only a few hours before it would start, player Wormbow of Uldarash snuck into Bardonian territory and stole 3 horses. Player Nibbles in Uldarash erected a giant lit-up sign reading "Poo" behind the wall. This seemed like it was a bit too taunting, so the Uldarashis took it down. So then Nibbles built another one, even bigger and brighter, and Dentro swiftly banished him from the Empire. Nibbles is then said to have changed sides, and he joined the Bardonian ranks. These big signs are why the Great Golden War is sometimes called the Poo War. Hilarious, in my opinion. The Uldarashi army had not slept for several nights when they were building their wall, so a flock of phantoms spawned and circled overhead before the imminent battle. Dubbed the Spirits of War, this is commemorated in the painting by player Osmak. Gorgeous. He has a YouTube channel. Go check it out. The hour of battle quickly approached that evening. Uldarash had its forces on the wall, the Bardonians were on their roofs, and the Var Alliance had peacekeepers woven into both sides, watching the players among them. So they all just stared and patrolled their sides. Just before the battle, a few Uldarashi soldiers snuck into the sealed-off tunnels under Bardonia. Rumknight9k, MLG Kid Dorito Fan, and Leafy Sheep. They all put on invisibility potions and waited for the right time to come out and strike. And soon enough, the time for battle arrived. Everyone received a notification in chat that the land Siege Camp and the land Bardonia started their war, where players could start blowing up TNT and looting chests in the Bardonian land claim. But the commanders on both sides ordered not to strike first. And so, even with the heat of battle officially on, no one moved. At first, they spat insults and memed at each other to try to provoke an attack, but this did not work. In-game days went by, the captors and the captives. The mercenary fighter, Alolan Vulpix, ventured down into Bardonian territory and began fishing in their moat, and the two sides inched out alongside them, starting a friendly fishing contest. Still though, some itched for conflict. Wormbow from Uldarash fell off the wall while fishing and died. She claimed that the Bardonians killed her with a fishhook, but this started nothing. Now, starting a fishing contest is one thing, but soon after, this Wormbow and Commander Whiskey Knight got married under a dirt smiley face built by Kichu. Congratulations, you two! Imagine getting married in the middle of a war zone. But again, even here, a rogue player named Yeke came around and killed Emperor Dentro of Uldarash. But this still started nothing. Both sides remained resolute, and patrolling still continued. Patrolling, distrust, and being on guard continued. Tons of players on both sides complained the whole time. It seems like Nibbles at this point revealed the Uldarashi wall plans to the Bardonians, where the room of respawn beds would be kept, so that players could rejoin in the midst of battle. But this would only be applicable if the battle even happened, as Kichu recounts in his journal that tensions had come and gone, and now, wait. The player Infinic of Tlahotl, one of the Var peacekeeping leaders, saw that MLG Kid Dorito Fan emerged from the tunnels and started to loot the Bardonian storerooms. He reported this to the other Var members, and just like that, by a failed stealth check, the peace was broken. The alarm was raised, the peacekeepers by Uldarash retreated, and some even joined the Bardonian ranks. Commander Whiskey Knight knew that this theft, even though it wasn't the only one that happened, was an act of war. He rallied the wall army together, and Emperor Dentro gave the signal. Attack now! Lighting off fireworks into the sky. The Uldarashi army marched down and occupied a decrepit fortress on the town's outskirts. The Bardonians fired arrows from their rooftops, being guerrilla trained to shoot through their thick bamboo defenses. The Uldarashi warriors on the ground took cover behind scant cobblestone blocks, firing arrows into the rows and rows of bamboo to no avail. There was no way that they could get over the moat and walls under this arrow fire, so Whiskey Knight and the main army held out in this very small fort, and the commander sent the warriors Timokin and Christmas Rocks to go outside the wall and sneak around the Bardonian line to the town's backside. There were no defenders here, so they laid down a line of TNT and blew up the ground defenses. Lava poured out from the ground, but if they were careful, the army now had a path into the town's core. The Uldarashi army marched out of the fortress and around the battlefield, but the Bardonians turned with them and they found the trench starting to fill with oncoming Uldarashi fighters. At this, Rumknight and Leafy Sheep emerged from the tunnel and slew a few defenders from behind, quickly retreating to avoid death. There was a storm of arrows delivered overhead. Surrounded by thorn bushes, cobwebs, lava, and bamboo, the Uldarash soldiers got stuck trying to exit their own trench. The Var soldiers at first kept them at bay there. As the attacking army's massive core came into the trench, the Bardonians' Azexis and Back to the Hub threw Ender Pearls from the rooftops into Uldarash's hind ranks, and with a devastating teleportation surprise attack, they cut down many attackers. The Temple of Dandelions exploded, and with that, the pitched battle began. the Bardonians and Var fighters rushed down into the fray. In the treacherous pit, they fought tooth and nail for the town. Potions hurled at crowds of players, TNT blown up overhead, and lava poured down upon them. People were on fire, poisoned, dying, and knocked back left and right. Another explosion in the trench revealed an underground ravine. The warrior Leapy Sheep fell in, but saved himself on a waterfall. He put on an ancient set of netherite armor which had super powerful enchantments that were lost to the rest of the server. He climbed out of the ravine and killed 7 Bardonians and Var before getting caught in their defenses and being finished off by Unicorn Boy. Both sides sustained many losses. Even many in Commander Whiskey Knight's group were killed and had to spawn back in the wall to rejoin the battle. But as they arrived, they found the Bardonians had successfully pushed the army out of the trench and back up onto their siege wall. The player Tizu used her enchanted trident called Sharkbait to leap up onto the ramparts. She then located the staircase down to Uldarash's room of respawn beds. So, when Uldarashi players came back to the fight, they'd run up the staircase and instantly be cut down by a mob of Bardonian swords. Some pleaded not to be killed just to retrieve their items from the battlefield, but it was an unmitigated slaughter. Soon after, Tizu ran down, destroyed the respawn beds, and the defense of Bardonia was finally won. The victors collected the Uldarashi war loot and buried it under their obsidian bunker. The town saw heavy damage to its landscape, the tavern, and the Temple of Dandelions. And while this destruction was a wound to their pride, it was overall an uncontested victory. Uldarash had planned a second invasion on the Bardonian capital, Durastorok, but that was forgotten about as they were now defenseless against Bardonia's revenge, and a few players were coming south just for that reason. 24 hours beforehand, Moye had smartly declared war on the Uldarashi capital of Sanctuary. So now Emperor Dentro and Kichu came together and guarded the capital city as the Bardonians and their allies descended. One can only imagine what they talked about, as the two original founders of the state waited for its destruction. The Bardonians Moye and One-Eyed Othanis, as well as players Loki Danuk of Vrylea and Eight Jaw Rude of Var, climbed into the floating city. They killed the two guards, ransacked the town, and blew holes into the walls. Unicorn Boy raided the Empire's claims in the Mesa. When it was all said and done, Bardonia had made off with more than $500,000 of Uldarash's money. This was 5 times more than the original indemnity that started this whole mess. Uldarash had been the richest of nations, with trade routes and vast economic systems to fuel its material wealth, but all of that was taken by Bardonia, their best gear buried under the battlefield and so much money carted off in spoils. The defeat saw Emperor Walusa Warrior step down, and Emperor Dentro pulled back as he became sick. Many towns in the north would split from the Empire and become independent once again. Kichu would even secede from Uldarash because he did not approve of the war, establishing the Second Kingdom of Peloro. Palavina and Sanctuary found themselves divided in two, just as before any of this had ever happened, split and broke. The remaining players of Uldarash toyed with the idea of becoming a republic, but instead, authority was gripped tighter. The commander Whiskey Knight had inherited one of Walusa Warrior's sub-kingdoms, so he portrayed himself as the Empire's regent and rightful successor, up until he became the sole ruler. The Uldarash and Bardonian leadership met at the Grizzly Bear Bar, a tavern at the center of the world run by player Carpicius. Everyone was amicable and they drew up a treaty. Bardonia would give much of the war loot back, and in turn, Uldarash would relinquish most of its claims to the Mesa, which would now be a free mining zone under protection of the Var Alliance. This agreement became known as the Treaty of the West, as it would put an official end to the Golden War. This new order was a fundamental change to Rathnir's politics. Whiskey Knight preserved the once dominant empire of Uldarash through this period of instability and smaller scale. He kept the empire neutral, moved the capital to the bustling city Hapatmidas, strengthened relations with Ardat Mosul, created a large alliance network among the world's southern nations, and adopted vital new vassals into the empire. Bardonia, meanwhile, would become one of the most influential powers in Minecraft history. They fought in the World War, tried a little world conquest, and maybe committed some politically motivated terrorism. Who knows? Uldarash and Bardonia are still alive today, but there's been a lot of history in the 8 months since the Golden War, the Minecraft conflict that would come to define everything. As an ending note by me, Mr. Jack Stoneblorks, this war is specifically remembered for both sides' sportsmanship and lack of toxicity. It's a model for how wars should play out on Stoneworks. People didn't take it too personally. This is the kind of thing that shows how amazing our community is and how we've brought Minecraft to its full potential. And for that, I'm seriously really proud of us. Stay tuned on Stoneworks Worldbuilding for more Minecraft Rathnir and worldbuilding videos. Subscribe and comment below since you've already watched the whole thing, and join the server so you can partake in its epic, lore-filled histories. Thanks again to Bisect Hosting for supporting this project. Use code STONEWORKS to get 25% off, link in the description. And a big shout out to my patrons, Rift Ranger, XIV, Tyler Hartley, Chance Morrison, Kenny Vetter, Sam Welch, Ben McFarlane, Fred, Joseph Varen, Travis, William Price, knock something over. Travis, William Price, and Ben Snow, you guys are so awesome. Thank you so much for supporting this channel. I super appreciate it, and I will get you guys on the flibbity flobbity dooped up. Bip.